Hello everyone out there on the internet, I'm Jack of All Trades, and this is one of three videos I'm doing for the new year, being my 10 favourite movies of the year. Just diving in, because I've got a bit of a long list, I'm going to quickly burn through my honourable mentions, which is technically making this a top 20, but here we go. Number 20, Black Widow. Not a fan, but it's not a terrible movie. And it ended up making it on my list, so here we go. Number 19, Cruella. It's alright. Not phenomenal or anything. It's rather inoffensive. Venom 2, Let There Be Carnage. I've sort of accepted that the Tom Hardy Venom, Sony Venom movies are just sort of their own thing with their own sort of tone that doesn't really mesh with anything else. And they're just sort of a fun thrill ride popcorn flick with a wee bit of an edge to it, which this one had less of because it was no longer a 15, can't have Venom biting people's heads off on camera. But it was good fun. And of course, the post-credit scene. No spoilers. Number 17, Raya and the Last Dragon. I want to say an average Disney film, but the bar for Disney films on average is quite high, so a slightly subpar Disney film. They could have done so much more with it. Some fun characters. I wish they'd stuck with the death that they did instead of undoing it at the end. That would have given this movie quite a bit more of a punch to it, but it was fun. Number 16, Dune. Chapter, part, one, volume, whatever. This is one of those ones where you go into the cinema and then the title comes up and it says part one, and you're like, oh. Okay then. Lots of big name actors and everything, and a lot of them didn't do much. Because, like, Josh Brolin's character sort of lead them all into the fight and then just disappears for the rest of the movie. Jason Momoa is there at the start, there for a scene, and then he's there for that fight, and it's... Because it's part one, we need to wait to see the rest, but just as a part one, didn't grab me too much. It felt like it dragged on a bit. Number 15, Eternals. I enjoyed. There you are. Number 14, Ghostbusters Afterlife. I'm a big Ghostbusters fan. I would have put it on the jacket if I had it, but it's down in Bristol. It's in a different country at the minute from me. Good fun. Great. Better follow-up than the 2014 one, the all-female cast one. This was great. Phoebe, that actress playing her, did a great job sort of embodying Egon to a certain extent. That sort of Harold Ramis performance. And it was really sweet what they did at the end. It got a little bit awkward. They sort of, without spoiling things, had the thing on screen for a wee bit long, and because there was no dialogue there, it sort of felt a wee bit out of place. Like at the start and everything, how they handled that was great, and the rest of the movie was great, good fun. Ending could have been a little bit stronger, and the post-credit scenes were great fun. Number 13, Free Guy. I think had it come out when intended, it would have had a better response. But then by this point, some of the references and jokes were a wee bit dated. But it was really fun having... Now Disney bought them so they could do all those jokes that they were able to do with that Disney money and Disney connections. And again, a lot of the wee video game jokes and stuff throughout were really good. I love the road tips up and you see the sky underneath, because that's how games work. You just have the sky be a wraparound thing. Oh, good fun. Number 12, James Bond 007 No Time to Die, Daniel Craig's last James Bond movie. It was good. It was a good James Bond movie, a good one for him to go out on. No spoilers, but yeah, really enjoyed it. The villain was a little bit weak. Had a bit more going for him, because it's Rami Malek. He's great, but we could have done with a few more scenes properly making us like or hate this guy, because otherwise it's like, okay, he's a bit of a dick who thinks what he's doing is right. Good for him. And number 11, Encanto. I know a lot of people really like this movie. I didn't quite connect with it. We don't talk about Bruno, the music number. Great. The character of Bruno, great. That's about it. I mean, the animation's beautiful and everything. Of course, it's Disney, it's Pixar, what do you expect? And I felt like the heel turn at the end from the grandma was a bit too quick, not quite well enough justified. But it's a good film. It's fun, it's pretty, some great songs. Yeah, I think this is higher than some of the others here just because of the songs. Okay, and then onto the actual top 10 list. At number 10, Supernova. This is very much sort of a character piece following Colin Firth and Stanley Tucci as a couple, and Stanley Tucci's character is suffering. I don't remember what specifically it is, but he's sort of losing his memories, or I want to say dementia or Alzheimer's, something along those lines. And he's afraid that he's losing himself, and it's him and Colin Firth going on this wee road trip, caravan holiday together, and it's really sweet. And they do. It's a really sweet movie that I'm not going to spoil any of these movies in this list. But, you know, I think it's better than everything else I've listed here. So if you enjoyed one of those, please check this one out. So this is a great wee character piece, and it's just them going through the British countryside and having those sort of talks that you do on, like, a road trip. And then, of course, their romance and relationship is just beautiful, and the ending. It's a really beautiful movie, and you come out of it a wee bit depressed. Number 9, Don't Look Up. This just came out on Netflix. It's Leonardo DiCaprio and Jennifer Lawrence discover a meteor that is hurtling towards Earth, try and alert the president, who's played by Meryl Streep. And it's just them. You're so with them throughout this movie as they're trying to get the government and all these influential people to help, and they're just concerned about the bottom line. And I was like, oh, there's gold on this asteroid. Okay, we'll mine it for money. It's like, what does it matter if we're all dead? It's so funny. And of course, you can take the spin of sort of it's a metaphor for COVID and everything with this movie. But it's very fun. It's a good sort of comedy. And then the end with people's mindsets about this and the debate around the meteor and the people who think it's not even real until they literally see it overhead flying towards them. But then some people just accept it. And it's like, oh, there's nothing we can do. It's the end of the world. It's good fun with a nice ending. And of course, all the actors do a great job. Again, it's DiCaprio and Jennifer Lawrence. Number 8, Another Round. This is a film from Denmark starring Mads Mikkelsen, where he is a teacher and he and some of his co-workers and friends decide to try out this idea where they will be drunk with a blood alcohol level of 0.5% or whatever. And just try going about their days like that, and seeing how being that little bit drunk, that little bit tipsy, sort of how that improves their lives. And it's like, oh, it becomes a better teacher, and has better relationships with their families and everything. But then, of course, they're like, oh, let's try upping the percentage and getting absolutely hammered, and they'll end up ruining their lives. It's a fun spiral, and I like the sort of upbeat ending to it, even though there's the downbeat before it. It's a fun movie of a bunch of guys who are like, let's try being a little bit drunk 24/7. And it's a fun exploration of that idea. Number 7, Bad Luck Banging or Loony Porn? Bad Luck Banging or Loony Porn? Am I gonna be censored every time I say the movie title? Bad Luck Banging or Loony Porn? Seriously. Bad Luck Banging or Loony is a Romanian movie that I got to see the British premiere of at the Inverness Film Festival this year. It is a hard R, it is rated 18, and the first 10 minutes of this movie, no, it's definitely an 18. It's this school teacher, Emily, her sex tape has been uploaded to the internet, and it's sort of the debate of the school and the parents of the kids over whether she should be fired for this or not. And so she didn't upload it. It's like, it's an interesting topic of discussion, and the way this movie goes about it is very, very fun. There's a whole section in the middle of the movie that's just telling you these Romanian words and the meaning behind them. Like, yeah, let's just give you this word and the definition of it. That's almost like a PowerPoint presentation. And it's sort of surreal. And then you realize, oh wait, no, this is giving you the background context for the current state of the country and the government and the education system to a certain extent. And then, of course, the internet and everything that's going on in that video, in that sex tape. It's a really funny movie. And again, if it weren't for the opening 10 minutes and then the ending, It'd be fine for all ages, but nope. That opening part, and then the end. They do it. It's not really spoilers to say, but they do it like Clue, where there's a multiple choice ending, or sort of at the end, the parents all vote on whether she should be fired or not, which I don't think is how that would work, or is at least who wants her to be fired or whatever. So then they have like three or four alternate versions of how that vote goes. And then the last one is just utter absurdity. And I would show the final frame of this movie, but I'm censoring this film's title, so there's no way I'm getting away showing that on screen. Number 6, DC Comics James Gunn's The Suicide Squad. It is so much better than the first one. Again, no spoilers, but going in, I wasn't expecting some of those deaths, and other ones I 100% was, where it's the case of, I think even when the first trailer came out or something, when they first, you know, the first like announcement of like, oh yeah, these are all the characters that are in the Suicide Squad in this movie, and you're like, okay, cool, we're gonna kill off most of them, and hoo boy did that not disappoint. I wish we got more Peter Capaldi. When I found out he was gonna be in it as a thinker, and he's one of the highlights, wish we got more. But very, very fitting role for him and everything that happens there. Oh, and a lot of the jokes land perfectly. It's a really good movie. The action, the character dynamics, like, again, Ratcatcher 2, one of my favorite DC characters now, just from this film. Just from this film. I don't know anything about Ratcatcher in the comics, but such a great performance. Sylvester Stallone is King Shark, Idris Elba, John Cena. So many great characters and great actors in this movie. Margot Robbie as Harley Quinn. This is the best she's been as Harley Quinn, in my opinion. If you haven't seen it, give it a watch. I do wish that they kept Project Starfish out of the trailers, because that would have been such an insane reveal in the theater. Number 5. Tick, tick, boom. This is Lin-Manuel Miranda's directorial debut, I believe. And it's the story of Andrew Garfield's character trying to get his musical produced, made, his relationships, friends and partners and things that were falling apart as he focuses more on this, sort of loses touch with some of them. It's based on a true story that I really need to look into, because my understanding of it is that this guy wrote this musical, and then one of his subsequent musicals was Tick, Tick, Boom. And then he kept writing music, and then he did Rent. And that's, I forget the name off the top of my head. But I know the guy's name from Rent. And then he died the night before the show premiered, and it's, you know, it's Rent, the biggest musicals of all time, before Disney started churning out Lion King and all that. And so he wrote this musical, I think. And now years later, Lin-Manuel Miranda has taken that musical and the story of him writing the previous one and made it into this. And it's really interesting. Some great songs. 3090 had me dancing around the kitchen as I was making breakfast, and it's been on my Spotify playlist recently as well. It's, again, the music's great, and I feel like that's a connection with this and Encanto. Lin-Manuel Miranda's music, he's great at this stuff. And not a bad director, going by this movie. Number 4. Love and Monsters. This came out on Netflix, I believe. And it's a really fun idea. If I haven't read the book it's based on or anything, but it feels like sort of a kids to young adult age book that's just been turned into this really good sort of family film. Where it's a meteor was falling to Earth, and humans, we did what we always do, except from in Don't Look Up. But we launched some nukes, and we blew it up, and everything there was saved. And then the radiation rained down and mutated all cold-blooded creatures, so we now have massive amphibians and reptiles and sea creatures and insects and everything. And humans are all hiding in bunkers underground and everything. So our main character finally finds via the radio the bunker that his girlfriend from before this all started, where she's wound up, and finds out, oh, it's not too far away. So he decides to go out into wilderness, trek through this world full of monsters and everything for the sake of love, Love and Monsters, there's your title, He finds a dog called Boy, and he is the best boy. And they go on this adventure to get to the other bunker to find his girlfriend from before everything went to shit. And the monsters are great. Again, they are just bigger versions of, you know, regular animals and bugs and everything. But the attention to detail for all of them is really good, and he's sort of he's writing this survival book for the world as he's going through. It's really fun. I don't want to give anything away, because, again, and there's a lot of sort of running jokes throughout it that pay off in a good way at the end. It's... The ending is the strong point, and sort of the relationship with the main character and the love interest is a really strong sort of anchor point for this. You have, like, Michael Rooker and not his daughter, but it's him and his son and this guy and his daughter and a bunch of other people were in a bunker. And then his son died and her dad died. So now the two of them are just off wandering the wilderness, fighting off monsters and everything, making their way in life. There's really fun characters in this. And again, the monsters are great. And some of the action scenes are really tense. The attention to detail, it's such a well-made movie. Some of the previous movies on this list are probably technically better, but I enjoyed this one so much that it's this high. Number three, Bo Burnham's Inside. IMDb has this on their list at number 22, so it counts. Okay, it debatably counts as a movie, it's a comedy special. Just know this is where it would rank. The 3.5. Actual number three, Luca. Pixar. Knock it out of the park once again. This is such a beautiful movie, and it's really well stylized and everything. It's no longer going for your sort of Toy Story sort of realistic humans. It's back to your sort of Incredibles heavily stylized human designs, and that works really well for Pixar here. Again, the animation's brilliant in this. The water effects and everything are great, but it's a really simple story. And it made me realize we need more movies like this these days. We don't need our high concept, fantasy, crazy stories of twist villains or Toy Story 4 where there kind of debatably is no villain. We don't need that stuff. Just give us, yeah, this guy's a bully. He's annoying. He's a jerk. And the goal is to win this triathlon of swimming, eating pasta, and cycling because we're in Italy. And they want to win so they can get a motorbike, so they can get a Vespa. It's great fun. It's a really simple and heartfelt story. I mean, it's been covered to death because it's so good. There are hundreds of videos you can watch analyzing and breaking this thing down. Again, the technicals are great. The emotional beats are great. I want to check out Ciao Alberto, I believe, the sort of Disney Plus spin-off that they've done for this movie, because it's such a good movie. But yeah, it's my number three. Number two, again, I don't want this video to be too long because I need to edit these and get these out sooner rather than later. Number two, I could talk about this for hours, and I have. Link in the corner to me and Dr. Neeltipus talking about it. Number two, Spider-Man No Way Home. This is a really difficult movie to talk about without spoiling it. So my short but sweet review is I went to see Avengers Endgame. At the same cinema I saw this, I went to a double bill where they played Infinity War, and then it hit midnight, and Endgame started. You had a wee break to go to the toilet in between. But Infinity War, 5 minute break, midnight, Endgame. Endgame got one round of applause from our audience, being the on your left, everyone coming through the portals moment, of course. That got one round of applause. This movie got 4. Endgame, one round of applause. This Spider-Man movie, 4. No spoilers, make that what you will. If you want my spoiler discussion, again, the link in the corner in the description to me and Dr. Neeltipus talking about this for 2.5 hours, I think. And then number one, Luca and Spider-Man No Way Home are 10 out of 10 movies. My number one is an 11 out of 10 for me. And that's just for me personally. I love this movie. This is my favorite movie of the year and one of my favorite movies of all time. You remember when Up came out and everyone was saying, oh, the first 10 minutes of Up made you cry? First time I watched this movie, snuggled up, open Netflix, blanket, sitting there, I cried in the first six. The Mitchells versus the Machines is my favorite movie from this year. So I'm an animation student, I'm an animation graduate now, but at the time I was an animation student studying at university, the subject that I love and I have such a passion for and I enjoy so much, just filmmaking and everything. And granted, a lot of this channel is reaction videos, but I like to think I sprinkle in enough creativity into this outlet anyway. Alongside my other ones, and Katie Mitchell, the main character of this film, has just been accepted to go to university to study animation. And it's like, she's an animation student. And like the opening of this movie alone, again, I cried in the first 6 minutes the first time I watched this. Where it's her, it's like, this is my personality, this is me, this is what I do. My parents haven't quite figured me out. It took me a while to figure me out too. This movie did not need to hit me so hard on a personal level. It's so good, and I love this movie so much. I've made the shirt, I've made the jeans with the eyes drawn. Okay, yeah. Katie is like the phrase "I kin a character" is quite cringy to me. Katie is one of those few characters that I can. I'm like, oh, this is me. This hurts. No, this is too close to home. Oh, but her relationship with her family and everything, and Aaron, her little brother, that was me growing up as well. Just obsessed with dinosaurs. If I can find it, here's a picture of me at like, I don't know, 7, 8 years old, holding a Velociraptor skull and kind of freaking out about it. I love dinosaurs and still do. Dinosaurs. It's like I went from Aaron and grew up into Katie. It's like I relate to these characters too much. And Mochi the dog, it's such a good. So it's this family and it's the robot apocalypse. And it's the robot apocalypse. We've seen that before. We've seen funny robot apocalypses before. This is a funny robot apocalypse.
And we'll create a new, better world without humans.
It is quite lovely. I don't get it.
These rockets will be outfitted
with zero exits.
Your flight will last
forever.
And your final destination
is the black void of distant space.
But we also have free Wi-Fi.
Olivia Colman is the main antagonist of this movie, and she's just a phone. She's your Alexa. She's your Google Assistant. And the jokes they get with this movie, it's so funny. It's super heartfelt. The moment when Katie realizes and sort of understands where her dad's coming from with all this stuff, that moment is so good. And it's one of those great reveals where, you know, they keep watching the home video of like Katie being strapped into like the car seat or something as a kid. And then they pull out and you get the rest of the context of the rest of that scene, and that informs the rest of the movie. I love your little twists like that. It has your. So, this is Sony Pictures Animation. It's Michael Rianda, more Gravity Falls alumni, and of course, Alex Hirsch involved, and Dana Terrace from the Owl House is involved in this. She was a storyboarder for this one, I believe. Lots of big names, and I don't want to say up and comers in the animation industry at this point, because they've all worked on all these amazing things, DuckTales, and again, Owl House, Gravity Falls, and this. It's Lord and Miller from the Lego Movie producing this. Again, it's Sony Pictures, it's Spider-Verse. Sony Pictures is fast heading towards being my favorite animation studio, man. This is such a good movie, and again, I don't want to spoil it. But, like, again, this is on Netflix. Don't care. Bought the physical copy. And, like, the cover. This is a CG movie with, again, some 2D mixed in and everything. But the cover for this is entirely 2D. It's just a drawing of the characters. It's a hand-drawn version of the poster. so good. It's so good. It's a movie starring an awkward, nerdy animation student. And I relate to that way too hard. For many reasons. Many, many reasons. Okay, it's not just me relating to the character. It's a really great movie. And again, because she's like into animation and making bad but amazing short films and everything. Dog Cop parts 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 and whatnot. But it's like, there's a moment. I paused the first time watching this and just sat looking at that screen for, I don't know, a solid 5 minutes or so. There's a moment when the robots first attack and Katie's sort of being flung through the air. And of course the animation's great. But they do it for the smear frame, but for the blur of something moving fast. They have Katie, they have this CG model of Katie. They then have a sock puppet version of Katie, because she makes puppet films, and then they have a 2D hand-drawn version of Katie. Just for that blur of moving fast, just for that wee moment to give the motion blur. They put in that amount of effort and detail. It's great. Again, it's the Spider-Verse and LEGO Movie people. And Sony Animation seems to be in this comfortable spot now where they're like, yeah, we'll make our Hotel Transylvanias and the things that keep the lights on that allow us to just give these people the free reign to just make these amazing movies and just throw everything into it. And it turns out amazing. And again, LEGO Movie, LEGO Batman Movie, Into the Spider-Verse, Mitchell's Versus the Machines. Which I'm glad they changed the title back. It was gonna be called Reboot, and they changed it to Mitchell's vs. the Machines. Which, I mean, it's disappointing this didn't get a cinematic release. It just came out on Netflix. But I really want to rent a cinema and watch this on the big screen at some point. Maybe when I'm back in Bristol. I know a few independent cinemas that might let me do that. But yeah, that was my list. Mitchell's vs. the Machines. It's an 11 out of 10. I know it's just been me sort of freaking out about it. Which, yeah, but it is so good. It is so, so good. Of all the movies on this list, in my top 10, I mean, Spider-Man No Way Home, it's pretty dang good, and I was considering, did it dethrone this? And then I rewatched this. Mitchell's Versus the Machines is so, so, so good. And again, it's on Netflix, please. I implore you to watch this movie and the story. Again, it's the robot apocalypse. But it's, you know, we've seen this hundreds of times, but it's still creative, it's still fresh, there's still great jokes and plays on it. Again, because the main villain's a smartphone, sort of messing with that idea. The rest of the robots, when the Roombas and the Furbies and the fridges and
delicate fluff and
fur.
Hey, what are you? Oh,
what are you doing?
Hello. Mom! Yeah.
We have been summoned into the field of battle. Forward. Oh no. Ouch. Ouch. The pain.
It is so, so good. I've said that too many times now. I'm getting very repetitive. Please, please, please go watch Mitchell's vs. the Machines. So yeah, that was my top 10 movies of the year. Top 20, I guess, if you count all the honorable mentions. Top 21, if you count Bo Burnham's Inside. Yeah, this is one of 3 videos I'm uploading, hopefully all back-to-back. Being my 10 favorite anime of the year, 10 favorite cartoons of the year, and this one, 10 favorite movies of the year. Link to the other two are on screen if you want to check out those. I do have a movie on the anime list, but I decided to keep that separate from this. Otherwise, again, a lot of honorable mentions of movies. I wanted to address a lot of movies because I know, again, people really liked Encanto, so it just was off the edge of my list, so I needed to address that and some of these other ones. But yeah. Thanks for watching. Happy New Year. I've been Jack of All Trades. Bye.